My name is Vesna Karapetrova, and we're here at Canadian Macedonian Place on May the 8th, 2015, to interview Mr. Slave Nikolovski-Katin for the Canadian Macedonian Historical Society. Welcome, Mr. Katin. Welcome, Mr. Nikolovski-Katin, here with us, and thank you for sharing your story for the archives of the Canadian Macedonian Historical Society. Let's begin with you telling us where and when you were born.
First of all, I would like to thank you for inviting me to be a member of this important Canadian Macedonian house. I used to write about this house, but now I have opportunity to be here and have an interview with you. Thank you very much for that. I'm certain that this interview will interest not only the society but also the people who is going to watch. I would like to introduce myself that I am a Macedonian person, a real Macedonian. From my roots are Macedonians. I was born where Tsar Samuel was born and lived in Prespa. And I was not far from the place, from the island where Tsar Samuel used to live. I would like to say that also I'm too close to the place of Alexander the Great, only 70 kilometers from Prespa to Pella. Therefore, I can say that I'm a real Macedonian, and I'm proud of that.
Yes, and the village that you're born in?
I was born in Ljubojno, actually between in Nakolec, and I grew up in Ljubojno. That was a war when I was born in
Yes,
that time.
What year was that?
1941. And I was born on the shore of the lake, Lake Prespa, very close now to the border, on the Macedonian land, of course. And I grew up there in Ljubojno with my parents, and I finished primary school in Ljubojno.
Yes.
Then I moved to Skopje.
Right. Tell us a little bit about your parents, who they were and where they were born and when they were born.
Okay. My mother, Sandra Grezlovska, Nichevska Nikolovska, was born in Ljubojno, and she was a tailor by occupation, a nice lady. She used to live in Toronto for 50 years, and she came to Macedonia to die in Macedonia. And she said, I came to Macedonia to die here, not out. My father, Risto, my original father, who I didn't met in my life, that was the time during the war, and he went in many countries, and he finished in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. Then my mother got married with Josip Nichevski. He was my stepfather, a nice person. We used to live for a period of 50 years together. And I am only one person in that family. And, you know, usually Macedonian family have more children. Like my mother used to have five sisters and one brother.
Right. And when was your mother born?
She was born 1920 in Ljubljana.
Uh-huh. And when did she come to Canada?
They came to, with my father, they came in the 1968 at the end.
Okay. Do you know why they came?
From economic reasons.
And you did you come with them?
Yes. I came here with them, and I stay here for a period of about 4 and something years.
Right.
And then I went back to Macedonia, and I'm coming from Macedonia to Canada for 50 times.
Right, so just about your roots a little more. How about your grandparents? Where were they born?
All right, my grand,
who they were.
My grandfather, Alex Oristov, he used to live in Detroit for 50 years, and he was a really nice person who spoke a couple of languages, and he was coming to Macedonia almost every 3 or 4 years, you know, to see the family, bring some money, as every petrol from Macedonia they were doing in the States or in Canada. And my grandmother, Kata, she was also in the States, and she came to Macedonia, and she didn't reach the village to Ljubljana, but she died in Bitola, and then she was brought in Ljubljana at the end.
Mm-hmm. Your grandparents then spent a lot of time in Detroit.
Yes, yes.
Do you know what they did there?
My grandfather used to work in Ford.
Ford?
Yes, for 40 years, while my grandmother didn't work.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and what language did you speak in the village with your parents, with your grandparents?
Macedonian, always Macedonian. We spoke Macedonian, of course, dialect of Prespa, mm-hmm. which you know, understandable or similar to all the dialects from Aegean Macedonia, like with Lerin or Kostur. We have many, many similarities, not only similarities, but we have the same language, of course, with some words. I'm joking because I wrote some papers about the dialects, and mm-hmm. always I know which word can be, it's used in Prespa, and it's used, for instance, in Lerin or in Kostur, or some of them differs.
Right. So, I know you were born in Ljubljana and you lived there for a number of years. You grew up there as a child.
Yes, yes.
What can you remember about your life in the village?
Well, Ljubljana is, at that time, was a big village, like a town.
How many houses?
400 houses. We used to have cultural hall, cinema, stores, restaurants, etc.
Right.
Everything what you know, Macedonian villages used to have. At that time, there was lots of people in the village. We have great library in the village, and Ljubljana is known with a great number of intellectual people who are all around the world. Just for Mark, I have a book concerning Ljubljana and everything, and I know so many data about Ljubljana and, of course, Prespa. For Ljubljana, there are over 60 medical doctors from our village, or there are 10 writers, 15 journalists, etc., etc. So many intellectuals all over the world, especially in Macedonia, in Skopje, Bitola, and other cities.
Right. And in your childhood, did you go to school?
Yes. Yes.
And what grades did you start?
Okay. I finished primary school at that time in Ljubljana.
Grade eight.
Grade eight. And then I went to Skopje and I enrolled at the technical school surveying department. And I finished 4 years in Skopje, the school. Then I came back to Prespa again.
And what language was your education in all
the time? Macedonian.
All the time Macedonian.
Yes, all the time Macedonian. I used to have excellent teachers. And at that time, as a child, we didn't have conditions as now the children have. We were glad if we find a book, even a torn book, but just to read it tonight and give it to my friend for the next day.
Mm-hmm.
I remember at that time my grandfather used to send us everything from the States, like presents and, of course, books. And at that time we were laughing as a children, as a child. English, we couldn't find this and that, but there were so many pictures, books, and they were interesting for us. At that time, when I was in the village of Ljubljana, I have so many friends from other villages, because Ljubljana is a center of about 7 villages of Brajčino, Nakolec, Dolno Dupe, Štrbovo.
And they came to Ljubljana?
Yes, they were coming to Ljubljana for school, and of course, as a community center, they were all connected with that community center.
Yes, that brings us to our next question. When did you go to school? What period of time was it? 19?
I was, my friends, after the war, they were 9, 10 at grade 1. Mm-hmm. But I was at 6 years old and I started.
And that was
1947, 48.
Okay, yes. So from 1947 you started your
yes.
education.
Yes, and then
you finished in
8 years, and then I went to Skopje. Mm-hmm. I finished technical school, and then I came back to Resen. I was working as a surveyor in the.
So you finished
assembly.
Your education
yes.
basically when you were how old?
1967.
1967.
Yeah.
And you were how old at that time?
How. 20
okay.
around.
Mm-hmm. Around, okay.
And I was working in Resen for mm-hmm. 2 years in the Assembly of Resen. And then I went to Belgrade to study engineering.
Great. Before we get to the latter part of your studies, when you were a child in Ljubljana, you mentioned that Ljubljana was like a hub for many other
yes,
villages.
Yes, it was.
And you had many friends from other
yes.
Villages.
What
do you remember about your friends and what you did with them, what games you played? You mentioned your love for books.
Yes. You see, the standard of the people at that time was not as high as it is now, but it was higher than in other villages, for instance, in other communities. Due to the fact that many of the people were in the States or Canada, they were sending money to the people, they were sending presents. I remember my grandfather sent me a ball, and one ball for football and another for rugby.
Mm-hmm.
We were laughing how we were going to play at that. We didn't know what is it.
Did you share with your friends?
Of course.
Okay.
And that was interesting for us. Or, you know, we had like shirts for the first time, written something, but, and we were curious, what is it? How is it? Why? Etc. That was interesting for us, of course. And like, Prespa is very close to our village, and we were good swimmers, and of course we were going fishing in the lake. And as a child I was a good swimmer. I was strong. Now I'm old, but I was strong, and I was a good swimmer. I used to play even water polo for Ohridski Branovi in Ohrid, and I was. Swimming marathon in Ohrid and in Prespa.
And how old were you when you participated?
That was about 20, 22, okay. 24 mm-hmm. years. But that was my hobby at that mm-hmm. time, as a student mostly. And it was interesting. You know, the life was different than now. As I said, that time there were 40 houses full of people with, let's say, 5 to 10 people in the house. Now you can find so many locks on the houses, unfortunately. And but still, we are going there. We have a nice house. I will say that I have also a library in my village mm-hmm. in Ljubljana. I have about 5,000 books there. And I have also books in Skopje, of course, but my library I keep in Ljubljana, probably where I'm going to do something for the people from Prespa, from the States, or for Resen. We don't know yet. We also have a room with costumes, mm-hmm. Macedonian costumes, and so many stuffs, all stuffs Macedonia, like Grninja, Vočvički, so on and so forth. That room belongs to my wife. she's a fond of Macedonian
artifacts.
Yes, artifacts. And it was interesting. Even now, as I said, it's interesting for us. We are going all the time there, especially for Ilinden, because Ljubljana is a place where Ilinden is one of the, I can say, the day for all the people from Prespa. Ilindenski sred, big gatherings are held in Ljubljana on 3 days.
And in August?
Yes, mm-hmm. in August. And many people are coming. There are music, folk fest, etc. for 40 years, 41 years. And that is interesting that many people, not only from Prespa and not only from Aegean Macedonia, who are around in many places in Macedonia, but also people from Canada and United States during that period, if they are in Macedonia, they are coming to Ljubljana.
So it's a lot of celebration.
Absolutely, yeah. Mm-hmm. Music and eating and drinking, of course.
And of course, all these celebrations are in what language?
Everything is Macedonian. Right? Mm-hmm. You see, I don't want to stress that Macedonian, but it is. We have Macedonian. My grandmother used to speak Macedonian from both sides, and the language was, you know, transforming from one to other person. And I can say that now my grandchildren, who are half Macedonian, half Italian, they speak perfect Macedonian, a perfect Italian, a perfect English and French. So, okay, this is new generation, but for us, for instance, for me, it was very important to know to speak language, to interfere in words and grammar, etc., to show up with my language. I am proud, I will be proud with my Macedonian language.
Wonderful. And now we can go to the latter part of your studies. After you finished in Skopje.
Yes, I went to Belgrade.
Yes. And what did you study
there? I enrolled at the technical faculty in Belgrade to study surveying also, because I finished survey technical school in Skopje. And I finished 2 years. Like at that time they were... you can have 2 years and 4 years. And I finished that 4 years, but I enrolled in the third year to continue. My parents were here, and I came to Canada. And I was working here as a surveyor.
So you
as
left Macedonia
no,
when?
66, yeah, from Belgrade, I came to Toronto, mm-hmm. to Canada. And I was working for a big survey company here.
Okay.
And they immediately sent me on the field to to make money for them and for myself. And I was working for a period of about 4 years. And then I went to Macedonia. I was going back and forth to Macedonia during I was here.
Yes.
Almost every year, but after 4 years I went to Macedonia, four and something.
Mm-hmm.
I went there and I enrolled at the faculty in Skopje, philological faculty, to study Macedonian language and English language and literature.
Now tell us about that decision. You had already established a career in surveying, had some experience here in Canada, yet you felt that you wanted to go back to Macedonia and do this. Was that a conscious decision? And tell us about why
you decided to study Macedonian. I enrolled in Ryerson school, first of all. My English was not as good as supposed to be. I don't know, probably. And it was very expensive for me and for my family to enroll in any faculty in Canada. And I had opportunity in Skopje to be there without any enrollment. Now I didn't pay anything. So I have decided, I said, let's go there and finish university. So I went there, and as I said, I enrolled at the philology faculty, the philological faculty in Skopje, at the University of St. Kirill and Methodi. And I finished that faculty very quickly, in less than 4 years. I was not a good student, but I was laughing. I remember I had a teacher from England, and he taught us Old English. And my written paper was okay, like 4.8. But I expressed myself much better than I wrote in the paper. And the professor, he said, I'm sorry, I'm not good. I cannot give you more than 8
8 out of 10,
yeah.
Yes?
Mm-hmm. I said, no, it's too much 8. I need 7. I said, no, I'm sorry, but 8? No, I said, my level is 7, so please give me 7 and I will finish the faculty.
So you were studying English in Macedonia?
Macedonian, yes, literature and language. I was interested in literature. At that time, I was working as a journalist.
In Macedonia?
Well, I have started here in Toronto. I don't know how long have you been in Toronto, but I started with Duchovna Iskra. That was a publication of the Church of St. Clement of Ohrid.
Toronto?
Yes, mm-hmm. In Toronto. At that time, I remember the priest who was a friend of mine, Atanas Popovsky.
And this would be
1967, 68. Yes. And then I was also involved in the church.
Tell us about your involvement.
Oh, yes. Okay. I belong to a religious family. My mother was religious and my father too. And even though we used to live in the, at that time, I can say in quotation mark, communist system, but it was some kind of a freedom. Nobody didn't say to us not to go to the church. Like in our village, we have 11 churches in Ljubljana. And every holiday we were going to the church, familiarly or not. Of course, there is some people who are not going and, you know, persuading us not to go there and do some that. But anyway, I was a religious boy, I can say, at that time. And when I came to Canada, I started going to the Church of St. Clement of Ohrid. At that time, I knew the priest who was here. And then in 1968, Metropolitan Kirill, who was my friend from Macedonia, he was enthroned here as a Metropolitan of Canadian American Eparchy. And he asked me at that time to start writing about him, take notes, and we will see what is going to be later on, of course. And 1968, when Philip Angelovski was the president of the Church of St. Clement, I was nominated for General Secretary of the Church. And I was for a period of 2 years before I went to Macedonia. I remember at that time, I would like to mention many people, of
please,
course.
Yes, yeah, who were yeah, the yeah, people yes, yes, yes. in the executive you worked with?
You see, at that time, Jim Jugloff, before that, who I admire him, and we were good friends, mostly because Macedonian language was connecting us. He was asking me about literature in Macedonia. We didn't have such a connection as we do now, Facebook, etc., so many social
media.
Connections, media, etc. That time was really hard, even if you can find a book from somebody to read it, it was perfect. And at that time, for instance, I knew Dorje Nikolovski, Tsana Georgievski, Steli Mariovce, they were in the executive, and they were working very with love to the church. They love the church. They love everything what they are doing. They love Macedonians in Canada. What they have here. That was the first church, and we were proud of having a Macedonian Orthodox Church in Canada, which was really something, and that church was foundation of other Macedonian churches in Canada, of course, in the United States. Probably later on we are going to speak, because I have a book concerning the Macedonian Orthodox churches mm-hmm. in Canada, United States, and Australia.
Great. So let's go chronologically. After right. you spent 2 years here in the executive
I went to Macedonia again, and I was coming every year to Toronto. I was working as a surveyor, you know, as a student, you have to make money. And I was making money for 4 months in Canada. I was going back again in Macedonia.
And then, how long did that, well, that back and forth for?
That was about, I can say, 4 or 5 years. Mm-hmm. And I got married. Mm-hmm. I found my love there.
In Macedonia?
In Macedonia. Yes. My wife is also a professor of Macedonian language. Mm-hmm. And she was an educator for a long period of time in Macedonia. And she was working in the Ministry of Education in Macedonia for a long time as an inspector. And also she's an author of Macedonian books for the schools, mm-hmm. about 20 books and other didactical mm-hmm. books for the
Okay, and her name?
Nada. Nada Nikolovska, mm-hmm. Ivanova. I'm joking because nada in Spanish means nothing. I said nada, nothing, but for me is everything. So, like my name Slave, they usually pronounce slave. I said no. Slave, it's better if you pronounce it like in French. Slave. Yeah. Slave means glory,
yes.
A birth. Mm-hmm. Nice in Slavic language. Mm-hmm. So. You know, languages, yes. Can be, you know, one language, one meaning, and another different meaning.
So when you were in Toronto, your time that you spent here, you were still involved with the church, and
yes, yes,
were
yes,
you involved
yes.
in other organizations?
Yes, in the United Macedonians as well. I was a member of the United Macedonian at that time, and I'm glad last time, a week ago, I was on the meeting for United Macedonians, and I was really glad to see from the first president of United Macedonian, Jim Sanders, to the last one. Mm-hmm. And I wrote an article in Macedonia. It was published in many newspapers and portals. And I said, the oldest Macedonian organization in Canada actually was United Macedonians. It was really Macedonians with national, I can say, path.
Have you done
future.
Research on the group and writing
oh, yes.
about
it? Oh, yes, yes.
Can you tell us a little about who started the Macedonian organization, the United Macedonians?
Well,
its roots, like you mentioned.
I wrote so many texts in my books about mm-hmm. United Macedonians. It was interesting, for instance, at that time, Želevo Hall from the village of Želevo, Lerin district, they, I remember at that time there was a beautiful hall, and they gathered there, and a certain number of Macedonians who were not belonging or belonged before to other organization, which is obvious, they wanted to start with a Macedonian organization, which will be national organization, and which will not belong to any country except to Macedonia. Because, you see, I'm familiar with the history of Macedonia, and the most important for the immigrants in other countries, let's say in the Macedon diaspora, is, first of all, 1944, the Republic of Macedonia, the Constitution of Macedonia, where we started Macedonian language, Macedonian science, Macedonian state, Macedonian this, Macedonian that, etc., etc., schools, and so on. So that was the foundation of the history of the future of Macedonians, not only in the Republic, but all over the place. Then, in 1957, Macedonian Orthodox Church, when separated, that when it became a separate Orthodox Church, that was also one of the stone for Macedonians, especially for Macedonians abroad, because I was writing concerning the churches, Orthodox churches. I admire to everyone who believes in God. Nobody can say you should belong to this religion or to that. Macedonians were always either to Bulgarian Orthodox Church or to Greek Orthodox Church. Some of them belong to Russian or Ukrainian, due to the fact that they were Orthodox and somehow they understood the language on the service. Now, when the Macedonian Orthodox Church came out as a separate church, started the first Macedonian Orthodox Church was started in Australia in 1961. Macedonians from Asia Macedonia who were not believers, believe me, I know all of them because I wrote about that church, St. George. Now it's St. George and St. Mary. But they loved Macedonian nationality. They loved Macedonia. They went to Australia mostly from the economic reason. Migration, it is a phenomenon for Germans, for Britons, from all over the world, and of course for Macedonians. Macedonians in Asia Macedonia have had different problem than we did in other parts of Macedonia. They were in a way forced to go out. They didn't speak Macedonian language in there in Asia Macedonia. They didn't speak their language, it was forbidden, and they went to other countries. These people who used to live in Australia at that time, started from Risto, Altin, Petrov, etc., etc., Yanov, even they were progressive with some ideas, but they didn't know that, or they didn't believe that they are going to be priests, but they loved Macedonian church, they loved Macedonia. And they started with that church, St. George, in Australia, and the many churches after that. Now we have 85 churches, you can imagine, Macedonian Orthodox churches in Australia, United States, Canada, and European Union. Some in South Africa, we have also a church in England, we have two. And we have one in Turkey, and probably, as we do have in Asia and Macedonia, one where the darkness is, and we hope in a recent time one in the Pirin Macedonia will grow up, you know, which is progress. Personally, because I am involved in religion after my work in Macedonia, probably, I don't know how many times we have.
Yes.
To discuss about this, but I can say that religion is very important for every nation. I was involved in the religion Macedonian Orthodox Church, and I was a guest of Serbian, Bulgarian, Ukrainian, Russian, Romanian head of the church, and we were discussing about
that. Tell us about that part of your career.
All right. In 1991, I was elected by the Parliament of the Republic of Macedonia as a vice president. That was the level to lead the Commission of Religion Commission for Religion Relations in the Republic of Macedonia.
91, that's when Macedonia
yes.
became
independent. Yes.
So it's very important.
Yeah,
date.
That,
yes.
That's very important. And I was the first person who was elected by the parliament, and I stayed for 8.5 years on that position. And of course, I had many many connections, many meetings, conferences, etc. And just for instance, I will tell you that I was received, of course, with a delegation, either with church or state delegation, 5 times in Vatican when Pope John was.
So the specific goal of
yes.
the committee was
yes.
to
you see the the commission was to have a good relation with the religious communities in Macedonia, first of all. But especially, there was written in the previous law in Macedonia that the commission was taking care of the Macedonian Orthodox Church, because the church in every Orthodox church in the state is separate, but belongs to the state. You can say Russian Orthodox Church, Greek Orthodox Church, Serbian Orthodox Church, Macedonian Orthodox Church. So the commission was taking care of the church. Now for people, I can say that Macedonian Orthodox Church is very important for Macedonia and for Orthodoxy, because even though we have problems with the Serbian Orthodox Church, unfortunately. However, Macedonian Orthodox Church has a school for priests, university, actually faculty, which is in the frame of the University of in Skopje. The church has more than 3,000 churches and monasteries in Macedonia, starting from 4th century up to now. And now, how you can say that Daha doesn't exist? I was laughing once. I had a lecture concerning the Macedonian Orthodox Church, and I said about the church on Sveta Bogorodica, Saint Mary in Ohrid, and Saint George in Kurbino in my Prespa. And they're amazing churches. Very old, and you know, everything is worth, everything speaks about the history, about the language, about everything. Balkan or in other country, so many people or so many nations and states were coming in Macedonia, and some of them were taking, or you know, nobody didn't leave anything in the states, but they were taken. Also, they were taken from our churches. You can find so many icons, frescoes, etc., part of the frescoes, of course, or any other items in all museums. I was from London to Belgrade and Moscow and Istanbul, and everywhere you can find Macedonian items.
Yes, and your love for Macedonian culture and religious religious icons and relics is obvious, and that's wonderful. Can we go a little bit more now into your love for literature? And
all
I
right.
know you created, you wrote many works. So you started with the with your writing for St. Clement, that was in the late 60s.
Yes, that was the first journalistic text for St. Clement and for Duhovna Iskra.
And how did your writing develop from there?
Well, every beginning is beginning.
Right.
So when I went to Macedonia, they involved me to write for Nova Macedonia and Večer, some of the texts concerning Macedonians abroad.
So these are newspapers.
Yes. And I've started there. But, you know, obligations as a student. You cannot be a student at a faculty and journalist. But anyhow, later on, I was in such a position when I edit books and magazines in Macedonia, and I had lots of time to write. And, of course, I grew up every day, and I was a better journalist. I brought everything what I knew about, because I traveled to Canada, to the States, and I went to Australia 3 times. I came to Canada 100 times. Anyway, and my beginning as a journalist was in Toronto. Then I've started cooperating with so many newspapers in Macedonia. And while I was in Skopje, I was brought from Skopje to Ohrid. There was an agreement between Hydrobiological Institute in Ohrid at Smithsonian Institution from Washington concerning investigation of the lake, biologically.
This is Lake
Ohrid. Okay. And so they took me to Ohrid as a translator, a coordinator of the work, scientific work. I worked there for 4 years. I was young and I was really working hard. At that time, my first book came out. It is English Macedonian Limnological Dictionary. Mm-hmm. That was my first book. And of course,
This was a dictionary about?
About limnology, about the fish, lake, biology, etc. What is necessary for this work with the biological investigation and science in Macedonia. At that time, I have translated from Macedonian into English one doctoral dissertation. I have translated also a book concerning the Hydrobiological Institute, who was 50 years old. And I wrote so many articles about biology, about limnology, about the lakes. I remember I've met Siniša Stanković. He was Serbian academician who founded Hydrobiological Institute in Ohrid in 1934. And I've wrote many articles about him, and I found out that he's Macedonian. You know how? We were on the lake, and with the fishermen, he loved fish, and of course we were drinking, you know, to eat fish. You cannot stay like that. We were drinking good wine on the lake. It was hot, and I found out that he's from somewhere from Western Macedonia, that he has to have some roots in Macedonia. And I said, dear professor, please, you have to admit now on the lake, nobody's going to hear me. Yes. Your roots, he said, my goodness. He said, Katin, I'm from Macedonia. You can't believe it. I said, how? He said, my dedo was from the part of Gostivar, and he moved to Zaječar in Serbia, and they were bakers, and they became rich in that town, and they sent him to Paris to finish university and to become a scientist. And he was the person, one of the persons, of course, who was top scientist in former Yugoslavia. And at that time on the boat, I said, will you write down that you have something Macedonian? He said, okay, I will. And he wrote down to me, and I kept that paper, that his descent is in Macedonia. And that was very interesting. Some of the scientists were, you know, writing wrong about me, they're like, I'm showing up too much Macedonian. I said, I have a paper, so please let him be whatever he is. He is Macedonian. He feels like that. So, okay. After 4 years in the Hydrobiological Institute, I was asked to be in Matica Naselenicite in Skopje. Matica is an association for Macedonians abroad. And I was a journalist in the magazine Macedonia, and also I was responsible for informative department with the Macedonians in the diaspora. And
Macedonia was the magazine that was sent to all Macedonians in the diaspora.
Yes, yes, yes.
And did you?
I participated. Yes, I was.
You wrote?
Yes, I was editor in chief of the English pages, on the English pages, and I, of course, I wrote so many texts about Macedonia. But they were coming to Macedonia, they were my guests. Mm-hmm. I was writing about folklore associations, known persons, organization, etc., etc. Of course, at that time, we had enthusiasm and great love, I must admit. And really, we were doing with love. everything what is happening with Macedonians everywhere in the world. Excuse me. Then I was elected, not as a politician, but I was in a political organization in the Central Committee of Macedonia. That is, it's called Committee for Working People. And I was actually, as a journalist, I was editing papers for that organization. And then in 1991, I was elected for the Commission with Relations of Religious Communities.
Okay.
And, and after I finished, after 8.5 years with the Commission, I again went to the Matica, Naselenicite, but at that time they Matica grew up as a ministry of immigration, and they took me there to be editor-in-chief of the magazine Macedonia. And after 2 years, I got retired. Mm-hmm. Of course, I went early than I was supposed to be, but I wanted to dedicate to my work. Mm-hmm. And during that, after that, I wrote so many books. Instead of having 10, I have now 50 books.
How did you begin? What was your inspiration?
Well, inspiration, Macedonians abroad were my inspirations. I've started with, for instance, with a book, Macedonian Diaspora, then Macedonians in Australia, or in Australia as a home, Macedonian Panopticon, that is one book. Macedonian Orthodox Churches in Australia, Canada, and United States. Macedonians in the States and Canada. Everything was Macedonian and mm-hmm. and Macedonians.
How did you go about your research? How did you get your information?
Well, while I was coming to all these, continents, I was always gathering material. I remember once I was when I was doing the book Macedonian Press in the Diaspora, and you can imagine the first newspaper came out in 1905 in the States. You have to find out which is it, how is it, where, and so on. When I was in Australia, they call me in so many places to discuss about the churches, about everything, about Macedonia, language, literature, etc. And I asked one old person, I said, do you have anything concerning newspapers in Australia, like Makedonska Nacija, Macedonian Voice, etc., etc.? I said, oh no, we have, but in the garage. No, it's not for you. I said, not for me? Please, tomorrow I will come here. Give me some clothes and I will do the. I was working two days in the garage and I found fantastic material for my books, not only for that books, for many books later on. So, books cannot be written in one day. It takes time. I've started with different the different subject for the diaspora. And I can say, again, Toronto was my foundation when I wrote the book about the family Janowski. And that was my first monograph concerning that.
And what year was that?
My goodness.
Well, approximately.
Yeah, approximately 15 years. 15 years back. Yeah.
So about
2000? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe before. Anyway, and then I wrote a book about a person from Australia. He is a journalist. His name is Andrea Branoff, from the village of Buff, from Lerin. And I've started one by one. I wrote a book about George Tomov from New York, as a dancer.
Yes, tell us about.
You see, Georgetown was only one Macedonian, and all the dancers and music were Americans. Most of them were Jews, but he used to have even a Chinese person who was playing in the Macedonian orchestra, you can imagine. And they were traveling all over the places. It's fantastic. They have opened and closed the Olympic Games in the States, skiing Olympic Games with the Macedonian dancing. And mm-hmm. they were surprised because Americans are dancing Macedonian oro. Mm-hmm. And they were singing Macedonians, you can imagine. George was really a great choreographer, a lover of Macedonian, and not only Macedonian, but also Balkan dances, because his group was specialized for Serbian, Bosnian, Croatian, Bulgarian, even they dance Albanian two dances. They have some Russian dances. He was international person, and he was showing up all the time with Macedonians, of course, because the name of the dancing group was Tomov dancing group and Macedonian dancing group. Then I wrote a book about Atanas Bliznakov. This is very important. I would like to say about Atanas Bliznakov. He was from the village of Dombeni in Kostor, AJ Macedonian. He used to live in Gary, Indiana. And he came to Macedonia in 1971-72, and he wanted to establish a foundation in Macedonia. I was a young student at that time, but he was a good friend of mine, and he loved me very much. We were discussing and planning what to do, how to do, how to use the money, his money from the States, but not to be touched and to, you know, to be useful for the young generation.
Like scholarships.
Yeah, scholarship. And that scholarship, actually that foundation is established at the University of St. Kirill and Methodist in Skopje. And it has 35 years from then. We have 350 students finishing the university, and really the foundation is great in the States, and the greatest, I can say, the richest foundations from a Macedonian person in Macedonia.
Do you know how he made his wealth?
Oh yes. Mm-hmm. He was real estate in Gary, Indiana, and when he came to Macedonia, his wealth was 35 years back, that was about $450,000. And two professors from the university, very smart professors, they did the statute of the foundation, so properly, and he was proud of it. We made a committee of the foundation, and the foundation to be in the framework of the university. So, you know, I'm always saying that America and Canada have the greatest foundations in the world. They know how to, or people who leave the money to the States, they know that they left the money for something. And all the foundations in these countries, in Australia, including, of course, are really something for the new generations. And this foundation of Atanas Bliznakov is also a foundation for new Macedonian generation. Mm-hmm. And I'm proud that, first of all, I wrote one book about the foundation and his life while he and his Tetka Slavka was alive in Skopje. And now this year is coming another book in Macedonian English. The first one was only in Macedonian, but this one is in Macedonian in English. Mm-hmm. I can say that the foundation of Atanas Bliznakov actually opened a path for other Pečalbari Macedonians, for other immigrants. There is another person from Chicago, He is from Smilevo. He's also opened a foundation at the university. There is a person from...
And his name?
His name is... I'm sorry.
Oh, no, that's fine.
Sorry, I will tell you.
Another book.
Yes,
go ahead.
Another book, yeah. And there is another person who used to live in France, in Paris, and he left a foundation in Macedonia at the Academy of Sciences and in Skopje. But Atanas Bliznakov was his picture how to do this, and he opened this foundation. This year, a person from Canada, Dr. Lefter Manche, who lives in Ottawa, he's opening a foundation in Macedonia. It is called by the name of his brothers. And fortunately, I am a member of also this, volunteer of this foundation. Lefter Manche is a good friend of mine. And he's supporting Macedonians from AG Macedonia. They are coming to, you know, for folklore festivals. As you know, there are festivals in the village of Charani in Lerin, but also there are other festivals in so many places there, where even though the Greek government is forbidding the artists and Macedonians to go there, but still they are going. For instance, Tanets, the greatest dancing group from Macedonia, used to dance in Ovčarani, which was a great day for Macedonian people in Aegean Macedonia. This year, the Human Rights Association from Australia, from Sydney, they will have a symposium in Lerin, and they will participate in Ovčarani as well, which is, you know, even though the Greek government and Greeks are, you know, forgive me, maybe I don't want
you
to...
You can, Macedonian, you can say it.
Okay. Imam jedan ljubav tekst na makedonski, ja zvikam, ko je antagonizmot među makedoncite i grcite? I ja spišvam deka antagonizmot među двата народа, ти ние сме различен народ. И по јазик, и по култура, и по обичај, и по лик, и по боја. По се сме различни, грците и македонците. И антагонизмот меѓу нас и грците постои од времето на Филип и Александар.
Okay. Yes, so that goes back from...
Yes. Yes. So the antagonism exists from the time of Philip the Macedon up to now, from the bottle of Chaeronea, where Philip won, and he fortunately at that time killed all of them, and there was more blood there, water in the rivers, and that antagonism, you know, every year came up to now. Now, even though in Bible is written that we should love our neighbors as we do ourselves, but this is not happening, unfortunately, on the Balkan Peninsula or in Greece or in Macedonia. And Macedonian people, especially from Asia Macedonia, were pushed to leave their native places. On these places, I went so many times. Going from one to other subject, but when I went to Dumbeni, when I was writing the book of Atanas Bliznakov, this, what I seen, that was really amazing, bad amazing. That was the church and the graves, the Greek government took the graves, all the graves, in one place. I said, this can be done by Vandals, by I don't know how many centuries back, when people were...
The graves were dug up?
Yeah, yes, yes, and put it one place, like one grave. Nobody can say that this is my grave. You can imagine if you touch the bones of your family, your parents, grandparents, Now nobody can find parents or something, and not only in Dumbanim, this is happening all over the place. Anyhow, so the antagonism between Greeks and Macedonians is due to the fact that even though we are Orthodox, there is no Greek nation. There is Macedonian nation, but no Greek nation. I will tell you why. The Greeks are prosvigi, which are Turkish and have Orthodox faith. I wrote about the minister Turkoglu, the previous minister, who is Turkish but Orthodox. They are mixed. Of course, they are Greeks. If you go to Athens, you will find really good persons to discuss about Macedonia. They admire some of them, of course. I have friends in Greece. But politics, it's not good. It's not good for either for Macedonia or for Macedonian people from Asia Macedonia. And now, even though the Greek economy is present in the Republic of Macedonia, they bought so many companies in Macedonia. They invest, which is good. We have to have connections on many fields. There are some translations from Macedonian into Greek or vice versa. Many folklore groups are going to Greece, and also Greek folklore groups are coming to Macedonia. We shouldn't hate each other, we should love. We are neighbors. I don't hate people. I'm in love with the world. I admire everything. And I have friends there. Usually we are discussing. And they're saying, oh, my politics is crazy. Mm-hmm. I don't know what is happening. But politics is politics. We as a people, we should have connection. We should, we have mixed marriages, culture, etc. Yes. So there is no other way than to live together.
Right, and your travels have taken you to many places.
Yes.
And so after you retired, tell us about some of your major works that resulted.
Okay, I was, for a period of 10 years, I was editor-in-chief of a publishing house, Makedonska Iskra. We published especially books for children, but also we published many other books for Macedonians in Macedonia and also for Macedonians in other countries. We published two books for the Literaturnoto društvo Braća Miladinovci Skopje. We published two books for Ratka Šapas here, for Neda Lozanovska. I was editor of the book about the village of Nevoljani, of Risto, I don't remember his last name. So
Kirajiev?
Yeah, Kirajiev, yes. And I involved myself in publishing books which are, I can say, connected with Macedonian language, Macedonian literature, Macedonian science, Macedonian people, not only there but also abroad. When I am on the books, I would like to mention the book about Metropolitan Kirill. As I said, from 1968, when he was appointed in Canada, I started taking notes, and of course I did a monograph concerning his work and life, and it was published by Makedonska Iskra and the Eparchy in Skopje, the Tetovo and Kumano Eparchy, and was promoted and in the church in Skopje. The promoter was the head of the church, Dedo Stefan, and Stavrojikov as well, and another bishop from Macedonia. I am proud that I wrote such a book concerning a great religious person, a great Macedonian person, a person who loved people, who loved the church. And Dedokiri was my good friend, and really I'm proud that I did that book.
And when was the book published?
The book was 2007.
2007?
Yeah, 2007 mm-hmm. was.
And he was still alive at that time.
Yes, yes, mm-hmm. yes, 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 yes. And I have a book. Now I did a book for Esma Recepova, great singer. She's a Roma lady, but she is an ambassador of Macedonian songs and culture. And she's a national artist of Macedonia, therefore such an artist in Macedonia, one of the first lady.
So she's been declared?
Yes, yes, yes. Yes,
and can you tell us who they are? Esma
yes.
is one, okay.
Esma is a phenomenon. You can imagine. They have, with her husband Stevo Teodosievski, about 20,000 concerts in the world. And they had 2,000 humanitarian concerts for people, for etc., etc. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, when I was, you know, writing book and taking so many data from all over the world, I was interesting when I found that she was singing in front of 200,000 people in Sydney, or she was singing 10 or 15 times more than anybody else in front of Tito and Gaddafi and the Indian president. She became a queen of Roma dances. Also, this monograph will come out the next month. It's printing. It's in print right now. And probably we are going to make a promotion in Toronto too.
That's great.
We are planning to come to Toronto and to go to the States. And I hope that Toronto will see Esma Recepova for second time.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful.
Concerning the books, maybe it's good if I... well, I'm sorry.
<There's> okay.
Sorry. As I said, I have the book about the village Nevoljani, which is Risto Kirajiev. Is the name, yes. And for me, I must admit that translation of the novel Alexander the Great by Ulrich Wilken, he is a German author, I have translated that novel in 1984-85 from English into Macedonian. But at that time it was really hard because the novel is translated from German into English, and I have translated it from English into Macedonian. You can imagine English, I learned German for 4 years and I know I speak German. It's very difficult to translate into English due to the form of the sentence. And again, I had to, you know, translate it into Macedonian. But anyhow, that was for the first time Alexander the Great to be translated into Macedonian. And now we have so many books, of course, translated with the subject of Alexander, Philip, and ancient Macedonia. And I can say that at that time there was no too much literature concerning the that subject. I was using English, Russian literature, and it's one of the really good book about Macedonian history. Ulrich Wilken, who was director of a museum in Germany, he didn't have too much influence by the Greek propaganda or by the English propaganda. He was, in a way, a person who didn't care. Even I found that he wrote, "I will write by myself. I don't care what they are going to say about." But this is the truth. Anyway, the truth of Macedonia, the truth of Macedonian language, the truth of Macedonian culture is written in so many books, in so many centuries, in so many countries. I don't want to mention in Macedonia, of course, but outside, which cannot be taken away. It is forever, and Macedonia will live forever. We know that many do not like neither the state, not the language, or the culture, or we as a people, of course, but nobody can. Thanks to 1944, thanks to 1903 Linden Uprising, thanks to I call the first uprising when Philip the Macedon won the bottle.
Badly.
Yes, thanks to 1991 when Macedonia became a separate independent state, democratic state. Of course, we'll have problem, like every state during the histories have problems, or mm-hmm. you know, subjects which should be solved in a certain period of time. Also, we will solve such problems. But the future is Macedonian.
Wonderful. And I wanted to just ask you about your motivation. Right from the start, you talked about your love for language and your interest in religion. What do you attribute that to? All along, you've traveled and spent a lot of time writing about Macedonian people, Macedonian history, culture. Tell us about what it is that motivates you.
Well, first of all, I must admit that I love Macedonia. I love Macedonian people. I'm fond of Macedonian language, literature, culture, of course, religion. Therefore, I have so many articles, so many books concerning all these subjects.
Why do you think that you're so passionate about Macedonia and wanting to write
every Macedonian is passionate in all these subjects. But I was, like I say, smart, and I show up with all these things. Many of them, they know maybe more than I do, but they didn't, you know, show up, they didn't present it, they didn't have chance to read it, to write it. I had chance to read and to present it to the
right.
people. I was traveling, of course, as I said.
And your family, do you think they encouraged you?
Oh, yes, very much.
Tell us about Katin okay. as your nickname and part of your name
yeah.
now.
I would like to thank to my wife, Nada. She was always by me, supporting me, of course, our children, Dafinka and Alexander. And, you know, I apologize. I did take lots of time of their life and, you know, place, and I have so many books I had to work, but we survived anyhow. My nickname Katin comes from my baba, my grandmother Kata. Her descent was from Nivitz in Aegean, Macedonia, on the lake. And she was a beautiful lady and very smart. She was not educated, but she was looking after our family when my grandfather was in the States. He was father and mother.
She
was, yes. And I call her Maiko, mother. Well, my mother I call Mamo, like nickname. And the people call me like Slavena Kata. Mm-hmm. And when I started writing, etc., I thought instead of, even I wrote my name Slavena Kata in some text, but I said, no, it's not good. I said, it will be Slavek Katin. This, I must admit this, I have a friend of mine from the village of very close to Lerin. He is a professor in Melbourne, in Australia. His name was Jim Pateras. I remember he came to Macedonia. I said, Jim, my friend, let's do something. And in the book of Risto from Nevoljani is written Jim Napateroj, like I did Slavena Kata. And then he said, no, I will be Jim Tomev. Interesting. You know, the names, our people, not only from Aegean Macedonia, from all parts of Macedonia, were coming to Canada, for instance, and they were registered. For instance, Nikolic, at that time Serbia was in Macedonia, and he's Nikolic in Toronto, or Pateras, because he came from Greece, or Petrov from Bulgaria. But, you know, last name, if you study the last names of Jewish people from every country, you will find many similarities with Macedonia. For instance, if Jewish people living in Russia, they have Russian names. If they live in China, they have Chinese names. So this is our destiny as well.
Yes.
But, you know, I think Macedonian people is a, I can say, meek people, love people, not aggressive. They respect everybody. They admire so many things, and God will give to Macedonian people good progress in future.
And now let's talk a little bit about your family.
Okay.
Tell us where and how you met your wife and who she is.
we were students in Skopje, and we met as a student. She was further than me. You know, men usually are, or boys usually are, not good as the girls, of course. And she finished Macedonian language and literature, and we met as students, and we used to live in Skopje for the beginning. Then we moved to Ohrid.
When did you get married? Yeah,
we married 1973. We met 1 year before 71.
Yes, and then
and we have two children. Alexander, first, he's a veterinarian doctor in Macedonia. His wife is also a doctor, a professor at the faculty. And our daughter, they have two children.
Grandchildren.
Sandra, by the name of my mother, and Dina, Kostadina, by the name of my daughter-in-law father. So, and the finca, because Kaskatoza lives here in Toronto.
This is your daughter?
Yes. her family, her husband is Italian. The children are Macedonian and Italian. They speak both languages, as I said. Isabel and Massimo. And we hope you have more grandchildren.
Do you presently live in Macedonia, or you live here for part of the time?
Both. Mm-hmm. When I said about our grandchildren, I published 4 books about the children when they finish 6 years on their birth date. we were gathering the drawings all the time and everything, what they have done as a children. And I did a book for it children with drawings and pictures, you know, something written, etc. As a document, they will say, aha, the books are in Macedonian, English, and Italian.
You have such a strong connection with Toronto, with Canada.
Yes.
And have spent a lot of your life here, like you said, in between here and Macedonia. And you've had an opportunity to work and observe Macedonians who live in Canada. What would you like to, and now your daughter lives here and your grandchildren, what would you like to advise perhaps the parents of the newer generation of Macedonians that are coming up?
I am aware of the life in other countries. Usually we say Vokotelo Kezovria Site. However, Macedonians, comparing with other nations, which are forgetting their language very fast. If you go downtown, you will see a Chinese boy, he doesn't speak Chinese, he speaks only English. So maybe he's a second generation. This is happening to Macedonians as well, but we call grandmothers and grandfathers usually were taking care of the children, and they were, you know, giving the language, Macedonian language, to them. And all of the families that had grandmother and grandparents, they speak Macedonian at home. Later on, of course, they will speak English. But I have many cases when family, like grandchildren from Macedonian descent, they are coming to our daughter to have Macedonian lessons because their parents are from Macedonia. They would like to learn Macedonian. It is good that in Toronto there is a cathedra for Macedonian language at the university. It's good that there are so many schools for Macedonian language. And of course the churches are the springs of that language, of the Macedonian language, and people is going to churches and they are listening to. And of course the language will, you know, it will spread around the people. I wish Macedonian will take care more about the language and, you know, speak to at home, to their children, Macedonian, because they will learn English on the street. But if they learn Macedonian at home, it's much better there. Keep it for home. But it's good if they know Macedonians. You know, the language is something in the body of the people, something which is taken from our parents, from our land, from our history, from everything, and comes naturally through our mouth. And it's important for our people not to forget the language, as I said.
Mm-hmm. And you have been very active in creating the more and more Macedonian books.
Yes.
And making sure that the younger generation has an opportunity to continue learning about their culture.
Absolutely. I am an author of, for instance, one children dictionary. It's called Macedonian English Dictionary, Macedonian French Dictionary, Macedonian German Dictionary. Now, always I wanted to be a teacher to our children to learn English, but not to forget Macedonian. to learn German and French, not to forget Macedonian. Also, these books, this dictionaries are translated like Roman language, Macedonian and English. Vlach language, for the first time, that in Vlach language, English and also in Turkish and in Albanian language, separately for the children. And of course, I am a modest author, but I wanted to contribute to for the language of our people.
Language.
Macedonian and English and German, of course. And you know, if you come to Macedonia, if you come to the seminar of Macedonian language in Ohrid, you will see people from many countries. They speak Macedonian. Some of the lectures in German, Austria, Russia, Ukraine, Poland. I spoke once to a professor. I knew that she's from Poland. I said, "You're Macedonian." She said, "No, I'm not."
Right.
But she speaks Macedonian.
Yes. You know, huh? So a lot of people are
absolutely
learning
many,
the language.
Of course, learning the language. Plus mixed marriages, not only in Macedonia, but in other countries, you will find, especially young generation, you know, not we, but the young generation will read the language. There are so many scientists in the world who are dedicated to the Macedonian language and science, you know. That's very important. And we in Macedonia are thinking always of having friends in the world, not only Macedonians, plus the Macedonians, but other nations, because we are good people and we love people.
Yes, so, I just wanted to ask you about your future plans. I know you've had a lot of books from the diaspora writing about people and their lives. Do you intend to continue writing, or what are your plans?
Oh my goodness. The last book which was published last year, it's called Svetotna Dlanka, The World
in a Hand, yes,
in Macedonian. And I included 40 countries that I have visited in the world, from north to south, from Argentina to Alaska, from Australia to Germany. And of course, in these 40 traveling stories, I was always looking for my people, for Macedonians in all these countries. And there are so many things, so many stories in my story about Macedonians. Not only because Australia, Canada, United States, and some European countries, there are so many Macedonians. But I found Macedonians not in these countries. Or I found interesting stories about Macedonians in other countries. For instance, I've been to Turkey so many times. And there are so many Macedonians in Turkey. Muslims and Orthodox. There is a church in Istanbul called Železna Crkva, the Iron Church, which is under the Bulgarian Orthodox Church, doesn't matter, but all of them are Macedonians, especially from Lerin and Kostur
region.
And I was talking to all of these people, you know, what happened, how it's happened. I know the history of the church, but I heard that many of them are Macedonians because they speak Macedonian in Turkey. Nobody did not forbidden them to speak Macedonian. Even when they go to school, they are saying, if you have a teacher, you will have your language at school. This is happening in so many countries. We have schools in France, in Germany, in other countries, but unfortunately not in our neighboring countries. I can say that concerning this book, this was my 50 book, and for my 50 years of working, my writing
career
as a journalist and writer, and 40 years of marriage. And we went, thanks to Steve and Lily Piakas, we went on a tour from Miami to Haiti, Jamaica, Mexico, and again back, and from there to Toronto by a car, and from Toronto to Macedonia, which was the longest journey for me in the story. It's in Macedonia, and I know it's a handicap for people, you know, reading in Macedonian, but there are many, many stories that can be found for our people, for the Macedonian churches, for known or unknown people all over the places. And that make me rich with my knowledge, with my, you know, views, everything what I have in my body to present to my people, to give or and to take from there everything what I need.
Well, it's very, very wonderful that we had this opportunity to speak together and learn about the very rich stories that you have written about Macedonian people around the world, and thereby making the library of the Macedonian history a lot richer. So we thank you for being with us here at the Canadian Macedonian Historical Society, and the interview will be seen by many, many Macedonians all over the countries that you visited, and by the future children as well.
Thank you very much. Probably I was a little bit excited while I was speaking, but I hope our people will understand everything what I said. At the end, I would like to say that Macedonia as a state was, while Alexander and Philip were great in the world, and they gave so much to the world. And now we have the same name after 44, Macedonia.
1944.
Mm-hmm. From the time from Philip to 44, we were calling us, or somebody were calling us, different names. Now, as every country has a own history, Macedonia has own history, a rich history, and I call everyone who is interesting of Macedonia, of Macedonian language, Macedonian literature, culture, etc., etc. I am pleased to give any information or on mail, Slavekatin at gmail.com, or they can see on my website slavekatin.com. I will be pleased to give any information to people all over the world.